A warm welcome to Balance and Dizziness Canada's webinar on helping others understand your dizziness. Balance and Dizziness Canada supports, inspires, and educates those affected by balance and dizziness disorders. We're the only organization in Canada that provides ad-free, up-to-date, evidence-based information about balance and dizziness disorders from a Canadian perspective. As a nonprofit society and registered charity, we are entirely funded by donations and memberships. We encourage you to visit our website for more information about balance and dizziness disorders, as well as to become a member or make a donation. We need your help to continue our series of free of charge webinars. Our speaker today is Tori Etheridge, a registered physiotherapist. Tori has a special interest in concussion, chronic pain, and vestibular disorders. She is passionate about patient engagement and empowerment. Tori has clinical experience working in public health care, private practice, and neurological research. Currently, she is the rehabilitation supervisor at the Surrey Plastic Neuroplasticity Clinic, where they focus on combining innovative technology rehabilitation to aid the brain to adapt, retrain, and relearn. Now for Tori's presentation.
Thank you. So we are going to start off discussing today about invisible injuries and how to help others understand your imbalance and dizziness that you're having. So to start off, an invisible injury is one that is unseen to the naked eye. So people with dizziness and other conditions such as chronic pain may have a very difficult time explaining their condition to loved ones because on the outside, they still look the same. It's, you know, there's not a cast that they have on, they're not walking with a walker, there's not something that people can visibly see to explain what's going on with you and how you're feeling. So without any of these obvious signs of physical injury, it's very difficult for loved ones and family members to understand that there's something very serious that's happening inside your body. So I've had a lot of clients tell me how the invisible injury can lead to a lot of frustration for the person who has the condition. Often clients explain how they feel very withdrawn from meaningful activities. They get very tired and frustrated about explaining what's wrong with them and how they're feeling. They are constantly between pushing through and burning out with their symptoms as well. You know, they feel obligated to attend events. They want to be there. They want to be a part of what's happening. So they push through, they do the event, and then they feel awful and horrible after. I've had a lot of clients also explain to me how they feel like they're constantly faking it. You know, they just put a fake smile on their face, try to ignore all the symptoms that they're having and pretend that they're okay. And they feel a real lack of authenticity, a lack of an ability to connect with friends and families as a result. So we're going to talk about advocating for yourself. I know it can be really tricky to advocate for yourself, and sometimes you might not know what to say, or you might not want to get into the discussion about what's going on with the condition that you're having. But I want to start with healthcare professionals, how to advocate for yourself with healthcare professionals. So you know your body best. You know what works for you. You know what doesn't work for you. You know what flares you up, what sets you off. And I think it's really important to make sure that you're coming into a session with your healthcare professional with this information and ready to share this information. I also want to point out that not all healthcare professionals understand vestibular disorders. Vestibular rehabilitation and assessment and treatment is a bit more of a niche area of practice, and not all clinicians or healthcare professionals may have knowledge about it or training on what the conditions are and how they may present and how it might be impacting your life. So you might have to educate them about your condition, what it is, and how it makes you feel. I really encourage people to interview their healthcare professional just as much as they're interviewing you. So you need to make sure that it's a good fit for you. You feel connected to the person, you feel heard, respected, understood, and listened to. Because the research about therapeutic alliance and therapeutic connection really shows that if it's a good connection that you have with the person that you're working with, your results will be a lot better. better. So it's really important to make sure that you are, you know, asking those questions to the person you're working with to make sure that it feels like it's a good fit for you. If you have a bad feeling, I really suggest and recommend moving on to someone else. You want to be with someone who is supporting you in your care, who's listening to you, who's validating the feelings that you're having. And trust your gut. If it doesn't feel right, I really recommend and I really urge clients to try and find somebody else. You want to build a team that's on your side. So how do you advocate for yourself? I know it can be quite tricky. First off, I would set some boundaries and ask for what you need. So tell your clinician how to best work with you. Often when I start working with a client for the first time, we spend part of the first session just kind of whiteboarding out, you know, what have they done in the past? What has worked for them? What has not? What are some situations that, you know, may have made them feel unsafe, not validated, not heard? Are there any words or phrases that I should not be using? Is there anything that might, you know, trigger you or set you off or just, you know, put the rehabilitation process on a bad first step? So tell your clinician how to best work with you. It might also be that when I get really symptomatic, this is how I present. This is, you know, my eyes might start to glaze over. I might stop listening to you as much, just giving them that heads up so that they know and they can look for that when they're working with you and doing rehabilitation to say, ah, those symptoms and those signs are coming on. I'm going to make you take a little break and I'm going to just back off from what we're doing right now. So that's why it's really important to tell the clinician how to best work with you. So telling your clinician what's worked in the past and what has not is also really helpful. And how to help create a safe environment for working together. With vestibular conditions, it's likely that you might have some good days and some bad days. So making this clear to your healthcare professional, you can even tell them, on a good day, these are the signs and symptoms that I have. And on a bad day, these are the signs and symptoms that I have. Getting assessed on a bad day, though, can be really helpful for the clinician to see what's going on for you and what a bad day looks like, because often in rehabilitation, we might need to make a good day plan and a bad day plan for your exercises that you're doing. And I just want to talk about, too, how a lot of clients tend to get really frustrated with this, but with vestibular conditions and vestibular disorders, some of the conditions, the testing that we do can be negative, meaning when we're testing the peripheral vestibular system, nothing's really coming back to indicate exactly what's going on with a specific canal or a specific part of the system, but you're still having dizziness and you're still having symptoms. So not every vestibular condition or disorder needs to have a positive test result in order to validate and show that you have dizziness. You can have dizziness with the testing being negative. So being authentic with your healthcare professional, we talked a bit about this already. If something's making you feel symptomatic, it is so important that you let them know. I have a lot of clients who, I don't know why, but maybe they just want to try and, you know, tough it out, or they want to just do as much as they can in the session and get the most out of the session. But they don't tell me, you know, how awful that exercise is making them feel, or they might go home and they feel sick for hours after or days after. If this is happening, you are doing too much. We don't want to push through the exercises. When we're doing vestibular rehabilitation, we want to just kind of peek into increasing those symptoms, show you how to recover them back down, and then we do the exercise again. So it's really important to express how you feel and what the impact the care has on you within the session and after the session as well. If you're not improving, if you've been doing the exercises and the similar rehabilitation for quite a while, and you're not seeing any improvements, it might be time to look somewhere else to find another healthcare professional that might be able to fit the needs that you're having more as well. I also really encourage people with dizziness to go on Balance and Dizziness Canada website and go under Find a Practitioner. They have a list of clinicians there who have completed certification courses in vestibular training. So what vestibular rehabilitation should look like? So first of all, I think it's really important to ensure the clinician that you're working with is actually a certified vestibular therapist. Sometimes people will take a day course or a weekend course and express that they're doing vestibular rehabilitation. But if you're having, you know, some more complex concerns and issues going on, it's really important to see someone who's been certified in vestibular conditions and has done the extra training. Exercises should really not be leaving you feeling symptomatic for more than 10 minutes after stopping. So this is really important, especially when we're doing rehab for exercises where we're trying to habituate, meaning we're trying to get the nervous system to be have a normal response to things like head movements. So we want to, you know, do some of the movements to increase the symptoms just a little bit so that the brain has something to work with, something that it has to figure out. And then we want to calm the nervous system down, bring it all back down to neutral so that the symptoms are back down before we're doing another repetition or another type of exercise. So vestibular rehabilitation should not be leaving you feeling sick for, you know, hours or days after your sessions. If you are, you may be doing too much. If you have headaches or migraines, the program might also need to be adapted. So people who have migraines, we know that their brain responds a little bit differently. And sometimes the vestibular exercises, the eye or the head movement activities that we're doing can cause more symptoms and cause them to be symptomatic for longer. So the program might need to be a bit adapted for someone who has a migraine or uncontrolled headaches. So vestibular rehabilitation, going through more of the key principles, depending on the condition or disorder that you're having, you might need a good day and a bad day program. So on a good day, you know, these are the type of exercises that we're going to focus on. And when you're having a day that you're feeling more symptomatic, or maybe you have more that you have to do at home or some big event that's coming up, we're going to tailor the activity and tailor the exercises that you're doing to match the needs of what's happening in your daily life. So it's always good to just kind of have that thought in your head that, you know, you might not be able to do all of the exercises every day, depending on how you're feeling and what else is going on in your life. And that's okay. So a good day and a bad day program is also a great idea. I'm just going to reiterate this again, because I think it's such an important point that gets missed often with people in vestibular rehabilitation. But if the exercises are making you feel worse, it is likely too much. Very important, okay? Vestibular rehabilitation should not be leaving you feeling awful and sick and spinny and dizzy for a long time after stopping. When we're doing these exercises, we really want to grade our exposure. So we want to grade how much we're giving you of the exercise, how much it's bringing up those symptoms, and habituate the brain. So we want to expose the brain to the challenge, give the brain time to figure out what to do with that challenge, calm the brain back down so the brain learns that it's okay, it's safe. It's okay for me to move my head this way. It's okay for me to turn like this. If we give the brain too much, it gets overwhelmed, it gets a little bit agitated, and our symptoms just ramp up and up and up and up, and we feel worse and worse and worse. So we want to gently expose the nervous system to situations that make you feel dizzy and teach your brain strategies to calm it back down. So explaining your condition to family and friends, we're doing a little bit of a shift here. I get this question a lot, and I think it's really hard, you know, especially if you're feeling quite symptomatic all the time and you're just kind of barely making it through the day, having the energy to explain what's going on and having the ability to explain what's going on. Because when we're feeling so symptomatic, our cognition changes as well. You might forget more things. It might be harder to process information that's around you. So I tell clients that sometimes it's a good idea to have a simple one-line phrase that you can easily say to people to explain what's going on. This could be something like, I have a condition where my balance system in my brain is not working properly. It leaves me feeling dizzy when I move my head around or whatever it might be. My brain is not reading the messages properly, and blank situations make it a lot worse. So I'm just going to read that out again. I have a condition where my balance system in my brain is not working properly. It leaves me feeling blank when I do blank. My brain is not reading the messages properly, and situations like blank make it a lot worse. So that's a simple phrase that you can use to explain what's going on. It's explaining that you have a balance condition. It's explaining that how it makes you feel. It's explaining the situations that cause it to change. And it's outlining that it's in your brain, and your brain is where the processing concern is. Also, some other videos that you can share with family or friends might be helpful as well. So Balance and Dizziness Canada, there's a link here that has videos on different conditions. And vestibular.org also has some videos. So a couple minute videos that you can just send so people can have a better understanding of the condition that you're having. Bringing your loved ones to appointments with you, I think this is really important. I've done this a lot with different clients. Sometimes it's to educate the family member independently. Sometimes it's to educate the client and the family member together. And sometimes it's to address some of the concerns that the family member and the client are having regarding their condition together. So bringing your loved ones to appointments with you can be a really good idea. Having the healthcare professional validate your symptoms that you're having can be very impactful to the loved ones too, because they're hearing it from someone other than you. And they're able to ask questions and they're able to, you know, gain a better understanding of what's going on and why it's happening. So it can help them understand your condition and they can learn how to help you more as well. I really encourage the family members to bring questions to sessions as well, because they might have some questions that are hard for you to explain or hard for you to answer. And having someone else there to do it for you can be really helpful. Talk about the challenges with your healthcare professional and ask for ideas on how to educate loved ones with particular concerns that you're having. Can be a really good idea as well. So make your limits known. I know this is a really hard one because you know, we don't want to have limits. We want to attend things. We want to be a part of things. We want to be with the ones that we love. But overcommitting can make it really hard for you to attend events. So when we overcommit, you know, we feel like we have to go and we don't know how we're going to feel on the day of the event. We don't know what our symptoms are going to be. We also don't know what the event is going to be like and how it's going to change our symptoms. So making it known to people that your condition fluctuates and you may not know until the day of if you can participate or not based on how you're feeling. So just giving that preemptive explanation about how you're not sure and this is the reason why can really help you make that day of decision to, based on how you're feeling. Also consider committing to parts of events and having a plan to exit and recover. So this has worked well for a lot of my clients, actually. You know, at the beginning, when everyone's getting there, it's usually a bit more loud and everyone's screaming and hugging and whatever it might be, maybe a bit different with COVID now. But I've had some clients where, you know, they attend the event a little bit after it started when things have settled down a little bit more and there won't be as much of attention on them when they have an entrance. So consider committing to parts of the event, you know, come in the middle and then leave, or having an exit plan to recover too. You know, I have some clients that set a little alarm on their phone, maybe every 20 minutes or half an hour, and it vibrates. And that reminds them to, you know, go to a quiet space. Maybe they leave the venue, they go outside, or they go to the bathroom and they just settle their symptoms down. So checking in throughout the event that you're at is really important too, because sometimes we get so carried away. You don't notice that your symptoms are going up and up and up. And then you get to the point where you're so overloaded, you're so symptomatic, that you've pushed it too far, you have to leave and you're feeling really awful afterwards. So checking in during the event, checking in when your symptoms are just starting to creep up, having an exit plan to recover, settle everything down, and then rejoin when you're ready can help you be there for longer as well. By verbalizing the limitations that you're having, you're setting yourself up for, as well as your family members, for realistic expectations. So just really verbalizing your needs, what might work for you, what might not work for you, and kind of setting them up for how the event might look can also help as well. So I just mentioned this, but it's really important, so I'm going to talk about it again. Really making your limits known and having a recovery strategy to implement before the symptoms increase too much. So that's really key when we're trying to attend events or activities. Just making sure we're not getting too overloaded and too symptomatic, that it's setting us up for failure and we're going to need a long recovery afterwards. Also, it could be helpful to educate about the type of environments and situations that are hard for you to be in. So letting family members and friends know, you know, busy places are hard for me. Or if you're sitting at a restaurant and there's a wall behind that has a lot of colors and patterns and stimuli, you know, letting them know that that's hard for you. So maybe you situate yourself in the restaurant so that you're facing more of a blank wall, or, you know, you're facing the corner so you can only see them rather than facing out into the restaurant where everybody's moving. They're all wearing different shirts that are different colors and different patterns. So letting them know about the type of situations that are really hard for you, and the ones that are going to cause you to become more symptomatic, so that maybe you can make a different plan, a different place to meet, a different time of day, or knowing that if you have to attend something like that, you're going to need a recovery period after. So by verbalizing those limitations, you're really setting yourself and them up for realistic expectations. See if you can control some of the environments that you're in. So I tell clients, you know, maybe go to the coffee shop beforehand, or, you know, check out a few coffee shops beforehand if you're wanting to meet a friend, and figure out the one that feels the best for you, that's the most calming for your symptoms, and then ask to meet there. And then consider the quiet time of day. You know, don't go during the rush hour of the morning or the afternoon. Try and meet in the middle of the day, maybe when it's a bit more quiet. Try and find somewhere, if you like open spaces and that feels good for you, that has more of an open space. If that doesn't feel good for you, you know, just considering the environment that you're in and how it might trigger the symptoms for your condition. Tell them how they can best support you to pace and plan as well. So if you're in a situation and you have no other choice, you know it's going to be very overwhelming and very stimulating. Saying, you know, hey, maybe you can kind of remind me every 20 minutes to just check in on how I'm feeling and to step out and take a little recovery break as well. With family members at home too, identifying which tasks are hard for you to do and which ones are easy for you to do. And see if you can share a bit of the workload for which ones are difficult for you. If you know that, say, unloading the dishwasher is going to cause you to feel really awful afterwards, seeing if you can get some help with that. Or if there's a difficult task that, you know, makes you really symptomatic, trying to space it out in the week so that you're doing it on days, you know, say on Monday, you're doing some things that are a bit harder for you, but then Tuesday you have a lighter day so that you can recover. And then you don't have another harder task to do again until a Thursday. So spreading out those more challenging, difficult tasks that really flare up your symptoms. Pace and take breaks and separate the hard activities throughout the week. I really like this. This is a document that I got from one of our social workers at our clinic here. And it's a good read. It's also on Balance and Dizziness Canada under family and friends page if you want to take a look, but it's called the spoon theory. This could be something that you give to family or friends or something that you just explain to them. And it's it goes through, but you don't look sick. And it's an interaction between two friends at a coffee shop. And she's trying to explain to her friend about, you know, why things are so challenging and why things make her symptomatic and how it basically, you know, takes all the gas out of her system to do A, B, and C so that by 3 o'clock in the afternoon, she's got no more energy or ability left to do the other tasks. So this is a really good document to just explain in a different way how you kind of have to conserve your energy for the things that matter most. And sometimes your energy is going to be drained by certain activities, and that means you don't have much for the rest of the day. So this is a good way to kind of explain it to family and friends using a story. So I think too, it's really important to surround yourself with facilitators. So surround yourself with practitioners who see it as their job to facilitate and help you rather than fix you. What I mean by that is the interaction you're having with your healthcare professional should be one where they're empowering you to take control of your care. They're teaching you strategies that you can do on your own at home to calm everything down. You're understanding the rehab process. You know why you're doing the exercises that you've been given, and you know how they're going to help you. You know, rather than every time I feel this way, I have to go see this person to get this fixed. A relationship like that, it's not really helping you solve the problem, and it's not helping you be in control of your care. I kind of joke with some clients that I have. I say, you know, do you want to go on a vacation one day, or do you want to, you know, go see your family out east? I mean, what are you going to do if these symptoms come on and I'm not there? I would love to go with you. I'd love to go traveling with you, but you need to be able to have strategies that you can use on your own when you're feeling this way. So that would be an example of a facilitator rather than a fixer. People who empower you to take control of your condition rather than making you feel like you have to rely on them to feel better. If you're not feeling heard or supported or understood, it might be time to move on from the person that you're working with. So in summary, I know we talked about a lot today, and I hope I didn't go too fast, but at least you can pause and rewind if you need to. You know your body best, so it's important to advocate for what you need, outlining how to best work with you and explaining, you know, what it looks like when you're getting symptomatic and what it feels like for you and how you're reacting and responding to the rehabilitation that you're doing. Ensure your healthcare professional is someone who fits with your needs and your values. If it's not a good fit, if it doesn't feel like a good relationship, then it might be a good time to try somebody new. Educate your family and friends on how to best support you. Set boundaries for yourself and for your family, and consider the environment and type of interactions that you're having and what you can do to control the situation a little bit more, and check in with your symptoms and how you're feeling, so that you can be there for longer. So I'll just see if anyone has any questions.
Yes, thank you so much, Tori, for sharing your expertise on helping others understand dizziness. That was great. We have a number of questions that have come in. The first one is, what can I say to people who make insensitive comments about my vestibular disorder? This person has Meniere's disease.
That's very unfortunate. I'm sorry to hear that. But we do see that a lot. We have lots of clients actually bringing in concerns like that. And again, it's going back to the invisible injury. And I mean, I feel that the insensitive comment is probably coming from a lack of education and understanding. And if the person is open to it, I would really use that as an opportunity to educate them about what's going on and why you feel the way that you do. And hopefully they're receptive and open to learning. If not, that's unfortunate. I mean, for them to be ignorant that way. But I hope that helps. That has helped in the past. We've worked with different clinicians and different family members who've had that kind of experience. And I think just empowering them to learn a bit more about it has been helpful.
Well, thank you so much. I'm sure that will be very helpful. The next question is, I've been living with a Mal de Barkmont syndrome for about 15 years, and I kind of just accept it as life, but I do have a frustration to share. Appointments to see a professional, you never know if this is going to be a good day or a bad day, and it can be extremely frustrating if I'm having a good day on an appointment day, particularly if I'm scheduled for tests. The last thing we want to hear as patients is everything looks good, when you know for a fact that everything is not good. Do you have any words of wisdom to share with us regarding how to handle the ups and downs while navigating the medical system at the same time? I would really appreciate it.
Yeah, that's a challenging place to be for sure. So I'm sorry that you're going through that. There's quite a few vestibular conditions where testing might come back negative, or how symptomatic you are really impacts the outcomes of the assessment. So I think what I tell clients for that is I often get them to just do a little bit of journaling, and I get them to journal what happens to them on a good day and what happens to them on a bad day. And they can send it to me, or we just make it part of their file or part of their chart. And testing, I mean, you can repeat testing if it is a bad day and you want to get a better capture of what's going on. But I think I'd also question it if you feel that that's how you're being treated. I'm not sure if that person really understands you and understands your condition and what's going on. And maybe it might be time to find a practitioner who better understands what's going on and is more receptive to how you're feeling.
Thanks. That's, I'm sure, quite helpful. The next question is, I've been on sick leave for almost a year with PPPD and am scheduled to start work again. My colleagues and boss know about my disorder. They've had it fully explained to them, but I still get a really strong feeling that they think I'm malingering and exaggerating my symptoms. I just really don't know what to do to get them on board. Do you have any ideas?
Mm-hmm. So I guess I would question what type of information they have about your condition. And I don't know who you're working it with it and how it works, but often as a clinician myself, I'll connect with the workplace and, you know, provide them articles, provide them information about the condition and how the person might be presenting and how to help them best. Another good option might be to have an occupational therapist on your side. It might be a bit harder to find one who works with vestibular conditions, but they can do worksite visits and they can kind of work with your employer to create the environment that works best for you and outline the challenges that you're having and recommend strategies and adaptations based on what's going on as well. So I hope that might be helpful too.
Thank you. Okay, the last question that we have received is from somebody who lives in a remote rural community. And they are wondering about who they can see for healthcare professionals. They have very limited options, so it's not a question of really choosing a different one if the match isn't good. There is a healthcare professional to help them. So what suggestions do you have for people in that circumstance? I'm sure this must not be uncommon in a country like ours.
Yeah, that's a good question. I think one of the only good things that has probably come out of the pandemic that we've had is that virtual care has really taken off in the last year with rehabilitation. And I think that I personally do a lot of virtual assessments for vestibular. I can't obviously do all of the objective testing that I would do if the person was here, but I can at least get an understanding of the condition that they're having and make recommendations for further testing or for rehabilitation that they would be doing. So, you know, going on Balance and Dizziness Canada website, looking at the practitioner list and seeing if any of them offer virtual care, it might be a good option just to do a consultation with someone who's a certified therapist if you don't have access to that where you're living.
Thanks so much. Thank you so much, Tori, for sharing your expertise today. That ends the session, and thank you all for attending.
Thank you.